What is the diabetes mellitus? The diabetes mellitus is a clinical syndrome that is characterized by the elevation of the blood glucose level. That is also called the hyperglycemia. What is the hyperglycemia? If the blood glucose level or the plasma glucose level of the human body is more than the normal range, that is called the hyperglycemia. So a clinical syndrome characterized by elevation of the blood glucose. You can say the diabetes mellitus is a clinical syndrome that is characterized by the hyperglycemia that caused by relative and or the absolute deficiency of the insulin. So what is the relative and what is the absolute deficiency? Absolute deficiency means the human body, pancreas, the pancreas of the human body is not able to secrete the beta cell of the pancreas. They are not able to secrete the insulin. That is called the absolute deficiency. And the relative deficiency means that means the beta cells of the pancreas, they secretes the insulin, but peripheral tissues that utilize the insulin, like muscles, adipose tissues, and the liver, they are not able to utilize the insulin. That's called the insulin resistance. That condition is called the insulin resistance. That's called the relative deficiency. So it's a chronic metabolic disorder that is characterized by the elevation of the blood glucose level that is caused by the relative and or the absolute deficiency of the insulin. Okay, we have already discussed about that, so we will continue. So there are the two types of the insulin, four types of the insulin. You know about that. Type 1, type 2, gestational diabetes mellitus, due to the other diseases. In type 1 insulin, what is the type 1 diabetes mellitus? So type 1 diabetes mellitus, that's called the insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. What is pathology? The pathology of the type 1 diabetes mellitus is the due to the pancreatic beta cell destruction, autoimmune disorder that causes the pancreatic beta cell destruction. And the treatment of the type 1 diabetes mellitus is the exogenous insulin. So we know about that. Okay, type 2 diabetes mellitus. Okay, what is the type 2 diabetes mellitus? That's called the non-insulin. Previously, it is called the non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. And the etiology of the type 2 diabetes mellitus is due to the dysregulation of the insulin secretion from the pancreatic beta cells or the insulin resistant to the peripheral tissues. Okay, and the treatment for the type 2 diabetes mellitus is oral anti-diabetic drug plus them or weight reduction and the diet control. Oral anti-diabetic drug, note. So insulin is actually given for the type 1 diabetes mellitus. It is also given for the type 2 diabetes mellitus when the oral anti-diabetic drug, they are not able to control the elevated blood glucose level. That's in that condition also the insulin is used in the type 2 diabetes mellitus. Okay, you know about the structure of the insulin. So basically the insulin, it is the chain of the amino acids. This insulin is the chain of the amino acids. So there are the two chain, A chain and the B chain. A chain and the B chain. This you can see the red, orange colored chain, A chain. This is the A chain. Okay, and this one is the B chain. And this the round structure, they are the amino acids. Okay. So A chain, it contains the 21 amino acids, and the B chain, it contains the 30 amino acids. So generally the insulin, it is the molecular structure of the insulin is the A chain and the B chain. They are the chain of the amino acids. They are the chain of the amino acids, A chain and the B chain. Total amino acids, they contain, they are the 51 amino acids. A chain contains the 21 amino acids and the B chain contains the 30 amino acids. So the total amino acids that contains in the insulin chain is the 51 amino acids. But insulin is stored in the pancreatic beta cell in the form of the proinsulin. So what is the proinsulin? So proinsulin, this is the structure of the proinsulin. This whole structure of the proinsulin. That means the A chain is connected with the, A chain is linked to the B chain through the chain of the C peptide. C peptide is the connecting peptide. This is the connecting peptide. So A chain plus C peptide plus the B chain is called the structure of the proinsulin. That is the insulin is stored in the pancreas, beta cell of the pancreas in the form of the proinsulin. But when the insulin is released into the circulation, they are the A chain and the B chain. So this is the structure of the proinsulin. Is that clear? So this was the review of the introduction. Okay. So we will continue now over. Okay, mechanism of the insulin secretion. So you can see in this picture mechanism of the insulin secretion. So mechanism of the insulin secretion, this is the physiology, actually this one is the physiology, mechanism of the insulin secretion from the pancreatic beta cell, So what happened? This is the pancreatic beta cell. This is the schematic diagram of the pancreatic beta cell. So this one is the membrane. You can see the cell membrane. And inner part is the cytoplasm, We can say the cytoplasm and the nucleus there. Okay. This is the pancreatic beta cell. So what are the stimuli for the secretion of the insulin? The stimuli for the secretion of the insulin are the generally basically is the meal, when the meal is taken or when the glucose is taken. When the insulin is secreted from the human body, when the meal is taken or when the glucose is taken, when the particles of the glucose or the meal, they reaches to the intestine, and from the intestine, the glucose and the meal, this food particle, they are absorbed, or we can say the glucose particle, basically the glucose particle, they are absorbed into the circulation. So what happened? In circulation, the glucose transporter are present. They are present. So they carry the glucose molecules towards the pancreatic beta cell. So within the pancreatic beta cells, within the pancreatic beta cells, glucokinase protein or the glucokinase sensitizer is present. And glucokinase sensitizer is responsible for the phosphorylation of the glucose. So what will happen? The metabolism of the glucose will be there. The enters into the mitochondria, and from the mitochondria there is generation of the ATP. The generation of the ATP. So we can say there is a potassium channel is present on the membrane of the pancreatic beta cell. So ATP generation will close the potassium channel. What will happen when there is the closing of the potassium channel? There is the persistent depolarization will be there. What will happen because of this persistent depolarization? There will be the opening of the calcium channel. That will lead to the influx of the calcium inside the pancreatic beta cell. So because of this opening of this influx of the calcium, what will happen? There will be the exocytosis. Exocytosis means the release of the insulin from the pancreatic beta cells into the circulation. This is the mechanism of the insulin secretion. I will repeat it again. Stimuli for the insulin secretion, meal and the glucose particles. When the meal or the glucose particles, they are taken, they enter into the stomach, to the intestine. From there, they are absorbed, enters into the circulation. The specific transporter that carries the glucose molecules towards the pancreatic beta cells, inside the pancreatic beta cells, within the pancreatic beta cells, glucokinase sensitizer results the phosphorylation or the metabolism of the glucose. So metabolism of the glucose will enter into the mitochondria. They will generate the ATP. ATP generation will lead to the closing of the potassium channel. So that will lead to the persistent depolarization. Because of the persistent depolarization, there will be the opening of the voltage-gated calcium channel. So that will lead to the influx of the calcium. Because of the influx of the calcium, there will be the exocytosis of the insulin into the circulation. This is the mechanism of the insulin. Now, mechanism of action of the insulin. What is the mechanism of action of the insulin? Okay. Mechanism of action of the insulin. So we know that insulin. What is the insulin? Which type of the... So insulin, they bind to their receptors. What type of the receptor? Enzyme linked receptor. I think in first year we have discussed about the receptor families. One type of the receptor is the enzyme linked receptor. What happened to the enzyme linked receptor? In enzyme linked receptor, so this is the schematic diagram. We can see that this is one is the schematic diagram. So this one is the cellular part. We can say the cytoplasm. And this one is the membrane, cell membrane. This one is the cell membrane. This one is the white portion is the cell membrane. And this one is the extracellular part. This one is the extracellular part. And this one is the intracellular part. And this one, this whole, they are the receptors. They are the receptors for the insulin. They are the receptors for the insulin. So they are the enzyme linked receptor. What type of the receptors? They are the enzyme linked receptor. What happened to the enzyme linked receptor? In enzyme linked receptor, they are present over the transmembrane of the cell. They are present over the transmembrane of the cell. So half part of the receptor, it is located outside the cell, and the one part of the receptor, it is located inside the cell. And the within the inside, the inner part of the receptor, it is attached to the enzyme. That is called the tyrosine kinase enzyme. This is called the tyrosine kinase enzyme. So this one is the extracellular part, and this one is the intracellular part. So extracellular part is called the alpha subunit, and the intracellular part is called the beta subunit. Okay. So what happened? Insulin molecules. So what happened? So insulin molecules, they bind to the alpha subunit of the insulin receptors. Insulin molecules bind to the alpha subunit of the extracellular part of the receptor. So because of binding of the alpha subunit, what will happen? Here will be the closer proximity. So what will happen? So when the insulin bind to their receptor, alpha subunit, so what happened to the beta subunit, or we can say the tyrosine kinase enzyme, that is linked to the, that is attached to the beta subunit of the receptor, that is intracellular part of the receptor. So there is the activation of the tyrosine kinase enzyme, or we can say the phosphorylation of the tyrosine kinase enzyme. So what will happen after the phosphorylation of the tyrosine kinase enzyme? Again, this phosphorylation, there will be the phosphorylation of the other protein. We can say the protein. So this one is the IRS. IRS is the insulin receptor substrate 1. This is the IRS1, insulin receptor substrate 1. So after the phosphorylation of the tyrosine kinase enzyme, there will be the phosphorylation of the other protein. So first protein that will be the phosphorylated within the cell is the insulin receptor substrate 1. So there will be the phosphorylation of the insulin receptor substrate 1. Okay, after that, what will happen? There will be the cascade mechanism. There will be the cascade phosphorylation, cascade network of the phosphorylation will be there. That means the phosphorylation of the other proteins which are present within the cell. The receptors of the insulin, they are present over the liver, they are present over the muscles, and they are present over the adipose tissues. Okay, so once this insulin receptor substrates, they are phosphorylated, then there will be the phosphorylation of the other proteins which are not mentioned here, but other proteins which are present within the target cell. So what will happen? There will be the cascade network of the phosphorylation will be there. So what will happen? Because of this cascade network, there will be the two type of the effect. Okay, this cascade network of the phosphorylation, it sometimes act as the second messenger, and there will be the two types of the effect. One effect is the immediate effect, and the second effect is the long-term effect. But what happens in this immediate effect? In immediate effect, there will be the intermediary metabolism. There will be the initiation of the intermediary metabolism. What are those intermediary metabolism? Carbohydrate, metabolism of the carbohydrate, metabolism of the protein, and the metabolism of the lipid. And in long-term effect, there will be the activation of the MAP kinase pathway. That is the mitogen activated protein kinase pathway. So that will lead to the, on the long term, that will lead to the mitogenesis and the, that will lead to the mitogenesis as well as the growth effect. Okay, this is not necessary. The immediate effect is necessary for the insulin, for the insulin effect. Okay, so I will repeat it again. The mechanism of action of the insulin, the receptors of the insulin, they are present on the target cells. What are the target cells? The target cells are present in the liver, muscles, and the adipose tissues. Liver, muscle, and the adipose tissue. So receptors, they are the enzyme linked receptors. Okay, so this one is the extracellular part, and this one is the intracellular part, and this one is the cell membrane. Okay, the receptor is present over the transmembrane of the cell. Okay, two parts of the receptor, alpha subunit and the beta subunit. Alpha subunit and the beta subunit, tyrosine kinase enzyme is linked to the beta subunit, and the alpha subunit is the extracellular part. Insulin molecule bind to the alpha subunit, that is the extracellular part. So when the insulin molecules bind to the alpha subunit, there is the activation of the receptor. Because of the activation of the receptor, it will lead to the phosphorylation of the tyrosine kinase enzyme that is attached to the beta subunit inside the cell. Okay, after the phosphorylation of the tyrosine kinase enzyme, there will be the phosphorylation of the FOS protein that is present within the target cell. That's called the insulin receptor substrate 1. Insulin receptor substrate 1. After the phosphorylation of the insulin receptor substrate 1, there will be the chain of the phosphonetwork. There will be the phosphorylation of the other proteins which are present within the target cell that are not mentioned here. So there will be the cascade network of the phosphorylation will be there. So sometimes this cascade network of the phosphorylation may act as a second messenger. Okay. So this cascade effect of the phosphorylation will lead to the two types of the effect, immediate effect and the late effect. In immediate effect, the immediate effect will be the intermediary metabolism. So you know about the intermediary metabolism, metabolism of the carbohydrate, metabolism of the fat, metabolism of the lipid, metabolism of the protein. And the long-term effect, they produce the mitogen activated protein kinase effect. What will happen in the mitogen? So that will lead to the mitogenesis and the growth effect. Okay. So this is the mechanism of action of the insulin over the target cell. That is, we have already discussed about that. Now the effect of the insulin. Okay. We have discussed about the mechanism of secretion of the insulin. We have discussed about the mechanism of action of the insulin. So mechanism of action, after the mechanism of action, receptors are present over the target cells. What are the target cells? Liver, muscles, and the adipose tissue. They produce the immediate effect. What are the immediate effect? There is the effect of the insulin. So immediate effect is the intermediary metabolism. So what if the metabolism is produced by the insulin? That's the effect of the insulin. So effect on the liver. Number one is the effect on the liver. Okay. Inhibits the gluconeogenesis. So you know the gluconeogenesis. What is the gluconeogenesis? Gluconeogenesis is the metabolic. It is a metabolic pathway where there is a breakdown of the glucose from the amino acid and the lipids or the free fatty acid. So that is the inhibits the. That is called the gluconeogenesis. So, what is the effect of the insulin on the liver? The effect of the insulin on the liver is it inhibits the gluconeogenesis from the amino acids and the free fatty. That means that there will be the inhibition of the release of the glucose from the amino acids and the free fatty acids which are present on the liver. Okay, that's called the gluconeogenesis. Okay, second, inhibits the glycogenolysis. Or you know about the glycogenolysis. What's the glycogenolysis? The release of the glucose 1-phosphate and the glycogen which are present on the liver. That means the inhibits the glycogenolysis. Okay. Sometimes it also enhances the glycogen synthesis. That means the storage of the glycogen on the liver, storage of the glucose molecules. The glucose molecules, they are added to the glycogen, stored glycogen which is present over the liver. That's enhances the glycogen synthesis. And also inhibits the conversion of the free fatty acids and amino acid to the keto acids. That means the inhibits the ketogenesis. What is the ketogenesis? Ketogenesis is the formation of the ketone bodies from the free fatty acids and the free amino acids which are present in the liver. That's called the ketogenesis. But the insulin inhibits the ketogenesis. So effect of the insulin on the liver, they inhibit the gluconeogenesis, they inhibit the glycogenolysis, and sometimes they inhibit the glycogen synthesis, and the free fatty acids and the amino acid to the keto acids that will inhibit the ketogenesis. That means the insulin, how insulin reduces the plasma glucose level. By inhibiting the gluconeogenesis. That means inhibition of the secretion of the glucose from the free fatty acids and the amino acid into the circulation. So what will happen? There will be the reduction of the glucose into the circulation. That's called the inhibiting the gluconeogenesis. Okay, by inhibiting the glycogenolysis. So what will happen? There will be the inhibition of the glycogen into the glucose 1-phosphate and the glycogen into the circulation. Effect on the liver. Okay, effect on the liver. Inhibits the gluconeogenesis, inhibits the glycogenolysis and the inhibits the conversion of the free fatty acid, the amino acid, to the ketone acid. That is the inhibition of the ketogenesis. That's the effect on the insulin. Okay, effect on the liver. Okay. Now, effect on the muscles. What are the effect of the muscle? Effect of the insulin on the muscles. Okay, increase the protein synthesis, increase the glycogen synthesis, increase the amino acid and the glucose uptake. Increase the amino acid and the glucose uptake from the circulation. So what will happen effect? They reduces the circulation, they reduces the glucose level which are present in the circulation. Increase the amino acid and the increase the glucose uptake. Okay, effect on the muscles, increase the protein synthesis, increase the glycogen synthesis, the increase uptake of the amino acid and the glucose from the circulation. By increasing the uptake of the glucose from the circulation, what will happen? It reduces the insulin, reduces the excessive level of the glucose present into the circulation. That's the effect on the circulation. Okay, should I continue?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now the effect on the adipose tissue. Other than this, increases the glucose uptake from the circulation. They increases the glucose uptake from the circulation. By increasing the glucose uptake from the circulation, what will happen? Increases the excessive level of the glucose which are present into the circulation. Other than that, they also increases the they enhance the lipogenesis. What is the lipogenesis? Increase lipid storage or the triglyceride storage into the adipose tissues, and they also reduces the lipolysis. That means reduces the lipolysis means. What is the lipolysis? Lipolysis is the hydrolysis of the lipid into the free fatty acid and the glycerol. That's called reduces the lipolysis. So effect on the adipose tissue is the increases the triglyceride storage, that's lipogenesis, and increases the glucose uptake from the circulation and reduces the lipolysis. So what is the overall effect of the insulin into the target tissue? So overall effect of the insulin into target tissue is what it causes into the liver. What is the effect of the insulin into the liver? The increases the hepatic increase, not increase, I mean the inhibits. I mean the inhibit, right? The increase in the wrong type of inhibit the hepatic gluconeogenesis. Inhibit the hepatic gluconeogenesis. Increase in right? This one is the wrong type of. They inhibit the hepatic gluconeogenesis. So what happened by inhibiting the gluconeogenesis? What will happen? The glucose production into the circulation, the glucose production or release into the circulation will be inhibited. Okay, and they increases the hepatic glycogen deposition. By increasing the hepatic glycogen deposition, what will happen? Uptake the glucose from the circulation, and they increases the glucose uptake by the muscles and the adipose tissue so what will happen? The overall effect will be they reduce the plasma glucose level. So overall effect of the insulin is. So, inhibits the hepatic gluconeogenesis. Okay, in muscles, they increases the uptake of the glucose. In adipose tissue, increases the uptake of the glucose from the circulation. So, overall effect will be that they reduce the plasma glucose level. They reduces the plasma glucose level. Excessive plasma glucose level that is present into the we have already discussed about. Okay, so we have till now we have discussed about this introduction of the insulin, mechanism of the insulin secretion from the pancreatic beta cells, and mechanism of action of the insulin and the effect of the insulin into the target tissues. Okay, effect of the insulin over the target tissue. So when the excessive insulin is secreted, excessive insulin secreted in human body. Okay, so there's a two types of the insulin secretion into the human body. There's a physiological bolus insulin secretion and physiological basal insulin secretion. So what is a physiological bolus insulin secretion? So physiological bolus insulin secretion, after taking the meal, immediately after taking the meal, we can say the within the 2 to 5 minutes after taking the meal, is an excessive secretion of the insulin from the pancreatic beta cell. Why excessive secretion of the pancreatic beta cells? That's called the physiological bolus insulin secretion. So why excessive secretion of the insulin from the pancreatic beta cell at that time? Because to clear the excessive level of the glucose present into the circulation. That is called the physiological bolus insulin secretion. That's called the physiological bolus insulin secretion. Okay. Second type is the physiological basal insulin secretion. That means the in between the meal. That's called the physiological basal insulin secretion. Okay. The minimal amount of the insulin is secreted from the pancreatic beta cell. That's called the physiological basal insulin secretion. So you have to understand about the physiological bolus insulin secretion and the physiological basal insulin secretion. Is that clear? Any confusion?
No, sir.
Okay, now the insulin preparations. Okay, last slide for today. Insulin secretion, insulin preparations. Okay, they are based on the action of the onset of the action. Insulin preparation, clinical classification based on the onset of the action of the insulin. So they are basically classified into the four types: rapid acting insulin, short acting insulin, intermediate acting insulin, and the long acting insulin. Okay, we will discuss about that in the coming classes. What is the rapid acting insulin? So rapid acting insulin, like insulin dispro, aspart, and the glargine, they are the rapid acting insulin. Glulisin, sorry, and the short acting insulin, regular insulin, they are the short acting insulin. Intermediate acting insulin, insulin isofen, they are the intermediate acting insulin, and the long acting insulin, insulin glargine and the insulin D-tamer, they are the long acting insulin. So we will discuss about that in the coming classes. So insulin preparation, they are based on the action on the basis of the onset of action. That's a basically the insulin classification. The insulin, they are on the basis of the source also, like the human insulin. Bovine insulin and the porcine insulin. Human insulin that derived from the pancreatic beta cells of the human body. That's the human insulin. Bovine insulin, they are derived from the pancreatic beta cells of the cow. That's called the bovine insulin. And the porcine insulin, they are derived from the pancreatic beta cells of the pig or the pork. That's called the porcine insulin. Okay. So this is the classification. The important classification is on the basis of the onset of the action. They are the rapid acting insulin, short acting insulin, intermediate acting insulin, and the long acting insulin. Okay, so as we go from this 1, 2, 3 from up to down, the onset of the action of the insulin will be increased. Okay, rapid acting insulin, they are rapidly act. Short acting insulin, more rapid than the intermediate acting, but the less rapid than the short acting insulin. And again, the intermediate acting insulin, they are released later than the short acting insulin, and the long acting insulin, they are released that they act very late. That's called the long acting insulin. Okay, we will discuss about that in the coming classes. Okay, is there any confusion? So today we have discussed about the mechanism of the insulin secretion from the pancreatic beta cells, mechanism of action of the insulin, and the effect of the insulin on the target cells, and the some and brief about the insulin preparations. So once the insulin, when they are released from the, they are secreted from the pancreatic beta cells. Okay, they bind to their target tissues. So what are the target tissues? The target tissues are the liver, muscles, and the adipose tissue. That means the receptors of the insulin receptors. The receptors of the insulin. They are present on the target tissue. So what are the target tissues? The target tissues are the liver, adipose tissues and the muscles. They are the target tissues. So what are the receptors? They are the enzyme linked receptor. Okay. What is the enzyme linked receptor? That means, I think in first year we have read about the enzyme linked receptor, major receptor family. The receptors, they are located. They are located on the transmembrane of the cell membrane, or the transmembrane of the cell membrane. Okay, and they contain the two part, extracellular part and the intracellular part. So this one is the schematic diagram of the for the mechanism of action of the insulin. So this one is the intracellular. Green part is the cytoplasm. You can say the cytoplasm, and this white part, this is the cell membrane, and this one is the extracellular part. So this is the intracellular part, and this one is the extracellular part, and this one is the cell membrane. And the receptors, they are located on the transmembrane of the cell membrane of the pancreas. This is the target tissues. Okay. So extracellular part is contains the alpha subunit, and the intracellular part contains the beta sub. This one is the beta subunit, and this one is the alpha subunit. Okay. And the beta subunit beta saw it is attached to the tyrosine kinase enzyme. Beta saw unit is attached to the tyrosine kinase enzyme. Okay, so this is the enzyme link receptor. Okay, the receptor of the insulin is the enzyme link receptor. Is that clear? Okay, now what will happen? Insulin molecules. Insulin molecules. This is one. Is this chain is the insulin molecules. They bind to the alpha subunit of the receptor. Alpha subunit of the insulin receptor. When it binds to the alpha subunit of the insulin receptor, there will be the activation of the insulin receptor. What happened to the when it is activated? When there is activation of the insulin receptor, there will be the phosphorylation of the tyrosine kinase. That is attached to the beta subunit. That is attached to the beta subunit. When there is the phosphorylation of the tyrosine kinase, then what will happen? There will be the further, there will be the phosphorylation of the proteins which are present within the target cell. The first protein that is phosphorylated is the insulin receptor substrate 1 protein. Insulin receptor substrate 1 protein. Okay. After that, once there is the phosphorylation of the insulin receptor substrate 1 protein, what will happen? There will be the phosphorylation of the other proteins which are present within the target cells of the cytoplasm, within the cytoplasm of the target cell, the cytoplasm of the target cell. Okay. Then what will happen? There will be the cascade network of the phosphorylation within the target. There is the cascade network of the phosphorylation within the target cells. Okay. So sometimes this cascade phosphorylation effect, they may act as the second messenger. So after so many phosphorylation of the protein within the target cells, what will happen? There will be two types of the effect. One effect is the intermediary metabolism. That's a short-term effect that will lead to the metabolism of the carbohydrate, metabolism of the protein, and the metabolism of the lipids. Like we have discussed on the effect of the insulin in the liver, effect of the insulin in the muscles, and the effect of the insulin in the adipose tissue. And the second effect is a long-term effect that causes the mitogen activated protein kinase activation. That leads to the mitogen activated protein kinase activation. That will lead to the mitogenesis and the growth effect on the long term. I think that is not necessary. That is not important. The important is the intermediary metabolism. The important is the intermediary metabolism. So what happened to the intermediary metabolism? There is the inhibition of the gluconeogenesis. There is the inhibition of the glycosinolysis. There is the increased uptake of the glucose by the adipose tissues. There is the increased uptake of the glucose and the protein by amino acid by the muscle tissues. That is the intermediary metabolism. So this is the mechanism of action of the insulin to their receptors which are present in the target. Okay. First of all, the insulin is secreted from the pancreatic beta cells. So once the insulin is secreted from the pancreatic beta cells, they enter into the circulation and then they bind to their receptors. Once they bind to their receptors, they show their mechanism of action. And once they show their mechanism of action, they produce the effect of the insulin to the liver, to the adipose tissues, and to the this muscles. What are that effect? Inhibits the gluconeogenesis in the liver, inhibits the glycogenolysis in the liver, inhibit the conversion of the free fatty acid, the amino acid into the liver. So overall effect will be the decrease. They reduces the excessive glucose present in the circulation, or they also reduces the ketone bodies production. Okay, so what happened in the diabetes mellitus? So in diabetes mellitus, there is excessive hyperglycemia is there. That is excessive blood glucose level is present, and complication of diabetes mellitus is that's called the diabetic ketoacidosis. So what happened to the diabetic ketoacidosis? Severe hyperglycemia will be there, and there will be the presence of the ketone bodies into the circulation. So by giving the insulin, what will happen? Once the insulin is given, they reduces the plasma glucose level, and they reduces the ketone bodies formation. How they reduces the plasma glucose level? They reduces the ketone bodies formation by inhibiting the gluconeogenesis in the liver, by inhibiting the glycogenolysis in the liver, by inhibiting the conversion of the free fatty acid, the amino acid, into the ketone bodies into the liver, or by inhibiting the by increasing uptake of the glucose from the adipose tissues and the from the by the adipose tissues and by the muscles. This effect will reduces the plasma glucose level as well as the excessive ketone bodies present during the diabetic ketoacidosis. So till now we have discussed about the introduction of the insulin. Okay, about the brief introduction of the diabetes mellitus. And in last lecture, we have discussed about the mechanism of secretion of insulin, okay, from the pancreatic beta cell, how the insulin is secreted from the pancreatic beta cell, mechanism of action of insulin, and the effect of the insulin on the target tissues like the muscles, liver, and the adipose tissue. Is there any confusion till now regarding those topics that we have covered under the insulin preparation? Everything is clear? So insulin preparations. So what are the insulin preparations? So insulin preparations, we have discussed about a brief about the insulin preparations, their classification. So insulin is also given exogenously. Insulin is secreted from the pancreatic beta cell in healthy person. But in case of the disease like the chronic disorder like the diabetes mellitus, there are two types of the diabetes mellitus, type 1 diabetes mellitus and the type 2 diabetes mellitus. So what happened in the type 1 diabetes mellitus? In type 1 diabetes mellitus, the pathophysiology of the type 1 diabetes mellitus is the autoimmune disorder. It's autoimmunity that leads to the destruction of the pancreatic beta cells. Because of that, what will happen? Pancreatic beta cells, that is the present in the islets of the Langerhans of the pancreas, they are not able to secrete the insulin. So because if they are not able to secrete the insulin, that will lead to the hyperglycemia. So in that condition, we need to give the insulin exogenously. So insulin are manufactured, they were developed and prepared. There were the conventional on the basis of the source. Their insulin preparations are prepared on the basis of the source. They are derived on the basis of the source, as well as on the basis of their onset of action. So if you go for the on the basis of the source, from where the insulins are derived, they are classified on the basis of the source, like the human insulin, bovine insulin, and the porcine insulin. What is the human insulin? That is the insulin is derived from the pancreatic beta cells of the human. It's bovine insulin. Insulin is derived from the pancreatic beta cells of the cow. In porcine insulin, the insulin is derived from the pancreatic beta cells. Only the extract is taken. Not the whole insulin, but only the extracts are taken from the pancreatic beta cells of the pig or your cow and the human insulin. Okay. Other insulins are also there. They are classified on the basis of their onset of the action that we have discussed. They are the rapid acting insulin, short acting insulin, intermediate acting insulin, and the long acting insulin. So it's very simple to understand. Rapid acting insulin, they are very rapidly act. The onset of action is very rapid. In short acting insulin, the onset of action is a bit slower than the rapid acting insulin, but the faster than the intermediate acting insulin. And in intermediate acting insulin, they act delayed comparing to the short acting insulin. But they are fast comparing to the long-acting insulin. And the long-acting insulin, they are the most delayed onset of action is there in the long-acting insulin. Okay. So we will discuss about the one by one in detail about the rapid-acting insulin, short-acting insulin, intermediate-acting insulin, and the long-acting insulin. Okay. Number one is the rapid-acting insulin. They are consist of the three types of the insulin. They are the insulin lispro, insulin aspart, and the insulin glulisine. Okay. There are three types of the insulin. They are the insulin lispro, aspart, and the glulisine. Okay, lispro, aspart, and the glulisine. They are the commonly used insulin, rapid acting insulin. Okay, now insulin lispro. Okay, we know that they are classified on the basis of their onset of action. Okay, so basically, this rapid acting insulin, we have to describe the insulin on the basis of the onset of action, their peak effect, and the duration of the action. Onset of the action. So insulin, when the insulin is administered subcutaneously, this insulin lispro, the onset of action of the insulin lispro is approximately 5 to 15 minutes. Okay. And the peak effect is approximately 30 to 90 minutes. That is half an hour to one hour and 30 minutes is the peak effect. So what is the peak effect? Peak effect is means the maximum effect of the insulin is achieved. It's called the peak effect. Once the insulin is achieved the peak effect, the further effect will be declined. That is called the peak effect. You know about that. The maximum effect achieved by the insulin, the maximum effect achieved by the insulin to control the blood glucose level, the maximum effect attained by the insulin to control the blood glucose level is called the peak effect. And once after the peak effect is attained, then the effect of the insulin is declined. That's called the peak effect. That is achieved in case of the Lispro. The peak effect is achieved 30 to 90 minutes. Duration of action is 2 to 6 hours. So insulin Lispro, onset of action is approximately 5 to 15 minutes. Peak effect is approximately 30 to 90 minutes. And the duration of action is 2 to 6 hours. Okay. Should I continue? Second drug that comes under the insulin, rapid acting insulin, is the insulin aspart. Again, the onset of action is approximately 15 minutes. Peak effect approximately 30 to 45 minutes. And the duration of action is 3 to 5 hours. Okay. This is the insulin aspart. Approximately onset of action is the approximately 15 minutes. Peak effect is approximately 30 to 45 minutes, and the duration of action is 3 to 5 hours. Okay, this I think this onset of action, peak effect, and the duration of action of the insulin aspart, insulin glulisine, and the insulin Lispro, they are similar. Not the same, but they are the approximately similar. Okay, should I continue? I think everything is clear here. Okay. Insulin glulisine. Again, the onset of action is approximately 15 to 25 minutes. Peak effect, approximately 30 to 90 minutes. And the duration of action is 1 to 2.5 hours. So when we see this onset of action, peak effect, and duration of action of the rapid acting insulin, what we found that their onset of action ranges from the 15 minutes to the 25 minutes. 15 minutes to the 30 minutes is the onset of the action. Peak effect, 30 to 90 minutes. That means half an hour to the 1 hour and the 30 minutes. And the duration of action, 2 to 5 hours. After their duration of action is completed, the effect of the insulin is declined. It's completely, almost completely declined. There are the onset of action, peak effect, and the duration of action of the insulin, rapid acting insulin. Okay, so rapid acting insulin, they consist of the insulin Lispro, insulin aspart, and the insulin glulisine. And their features are the onset of action, peak effect, and the duration of action that we have already discussed. Okay, is there any confusion? Should I continue? Okay, when this insulin glulisine are given, this rapid acting insulin, they are given immediately before the meal. We can say immediately before, 5 to 15 minutes before the meal. Or sometimes they may be given after 5 minutes after the meal. So that they are able to achieve the. So normally we have to remember that we have already discussed that about the physiological bolus insulin secretion and the physiological basal insulin secretion. So what is the physiological bolus insulin secretion? The physiological bolus insulin secretion means the in healthy person. First of all, we have to discuss in the healthy person. In healthy person, the pancreatic beta cells, they are able to secrete the insulin. So when the insulin is secreted in maximal amount, and it is secreted in the minimal amount. The maximal amount immediately after taking the meal. So what will happen when the meal is taken, like the glucose or the meal is taken immediately after taking the meal, within the 5 minutes, pancreatic beta cells, they secrete the insulin, the maximal amount of the insulin. That is called the physiological bolus insulin secretion. Okay, and the after 2 to 3 hours after taking the meal, the amount of the secretion of the insulin is reduced. The amount of the secretion of the insulin from the pancreatic beta cell is reduced. That is called the, and the, until the next meal is taken, the minimal amount of the insulin is secreted. That is called the physiological basal insulin secretion. So what is the physiological bolus insulin secretion? After taking the meal, up to 2 hours after taking the meal, that's called the physiological bolus insulin secretion. The maximal amount of the insulin is secreted. That's called the physiological bolus insulin secretion. And the physiological basal insulin secretion, after 2 hours of taking the meal to the next meal is taken, the minimal amount of the insulin is secreted from the pancreatic beta cells in the healthy person. That is called the physiological basal insulin secretion. So when the 100 unit of the physiological bolus insulin is secreted, the amount of the physiological basal insulin secreted is 10 times lesser than the physiological bolus insulin secretion. So if the 100 unit of the insulin is present after taking the meal, that's a physiological bolus insulin secretion in the blood. So during the physiological basal insulin secretion, only the 10 unit of the 10 unit per gram per deciliter of the this insulin is present in the human plasma. That is the secretion amount of the secretion of the physiological bolus insulin secretion and the physiological basal insulin secretion. Okay, so the why this rapid acting insulin? So aim of giving the rapid acting insulin is to mimic the timing of the physiological bolus insulin secretion. Physiological bolus insulin secretion. Should I continue? Any confusion? Is there any confusion? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Should I continue?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, short acting insulin. Okay, it consists of the regular insulin. The short acting insulin, they are consist of the regular insulin. They are also called the crystalline zinc insulin. They are also called the crystalline zinc insulin because these insulin are they also consist of the crystals of the zinc. So why they consist of the crystals of the zinc? Because zinc is necessary for the storage of the insulin. Zinc is helpful. Is necessary for the storage of the insulin. That is the reason the zinc is present in insulin in the forms of the crystal. So they are called the crystalline zinc insulin. Crystalline zinc insulin. Okay. Onset of action is about half an hour to the 1 hour. We know that the rapid acting insulin, the onset of action is the 15 minutes to the half an hour, whereas the onset of action of the short acting insulin is the half an hour to the 1 hour, 30 minutes to the 1 hour. Peak effect, again, it is about 2 to 4 hours. That was of the short acting insulin. Rapid acting insulin was the 90 minutes. Maximum was the 30 to 90 minutes, but here it is 2 to 4 hours. Thank you. 2 to 4 hours. Okay. And the duration of action is 6 to 8 hours. Everything is increased here. Short onset of action is also increased slightly. Okay. Duration of action is also increased slightly, and the peak effect is also increased slightly. That is the onset of action, peak effect, and the duration of action of the insulin. And the route of the administration is the subcutaneous. We know about the insulin, the route of the administration of the route of this insulin is the subcutaneous, but this insulin may be given intravenously in case of the emergency diabetic condition like the diabetic ketoacidosis or the diabetic like non-ketotic hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state. That is called the, we will discuss about it in the coming slide also. So you have to remember that the regular insulin can be given. Rapid acting insulin, they are always given by the subcutaneous route. Whereas the regular insulin, they may be given by the subcutaneous route or they may be given by the intravenous route in case of the emergency diabetic condition. Okay. I will repeat it again. Short acting insulin, they are consist of the regular insulin. They are called the regular insulin. They are also called the crystalline zinc insulin. Why they are called the crystalline zinc insulin? Because they consist of the crystals of the zinc, which are helpful for the storage of the insulin. Onset of action is about half an hour to the 1 hour. Peak effect occurs at about 2 to 4 hours. And the duration of action is about the 6 to 8 hours. And the route of the administration is the subcutaneous. And sometimes in case of the diabetic emergency diabetic condition, they are given by the intravenous infusion also. Okay. Should I continue? Any confusion? Only you have to remember here is the onset of action, peak effect, and the duration of action of the short acting insulin is the a bit longer than the rapid acting insulin. So everything will be increased when we go from the rapid to the short to the intermediate, and from the intermediate to the long acting insulin. Okay, other thing also, short acting insulin, they are also given to mimic the timing of the physiological bolus insulin secretion. Okay, sometimes the question may be raised, why the insulin are just given before the meal? Why the insulin is always given just before the meal or during the meal or immediately after the meal? Why with the meal only? Why not other timing, other time other than the meal? The simple answer will be it is not that the if you miss the meal, that may lead to the hypoglycemia. But the answer is the when the maximal amount of the insulin is present in the plasma of the human body, That is immediately after taking the meal. Either with the healthy person, because the healthy person is also taking the meal and the diabetic person that is also taking the meal. No, so immediately after taking the meal, there is an excessive level of the blood glucose is present in the body. Okay, so to clear the excessive blood glucose present in the body, insulin should be secreted from the pancreatic beta cell of the healthy person. And in the diabetic person, we know that the pancreatic beta cells, they are not able to secrete the insulin. So we need to give the insulin exogenously. So to mimic the timing of the physiological bolus and the physiological basal insulin secretion, it should be given immediately before the meal or the just after the, or the, before the meal or immediately after the meal. Okay. Okay. Now the intermediate acting insulin. Okay. Now this intermediate acting insulin, basically they are given, if they consist of the neutral protamine hexone and also called the insulin isoflurane. Why they call the neutral protamine hexone? Because they consist of the, here we can see in this, they are the suspension of the crystalline zinc insulin. That means the, they are the regular insulin. But they are the regular insulin. Crystalline zinc insulin is the short acting insulin of the regular insulin. But they are combined with the positively charged polypeptide protamine at the neutral pH. They are the suspension of the crystalline zinc insulin, they are, which are combined with the positively charged polypeptide protamine at the neutral pH. That means the, if the regular insulin, they are manufactured, they are developed in such a way that the crystalline zinc insulin are combined with the positively charged protein, that is the polypeptide protein, that is the protamine at neutral pH. So what is the advantage? Because of this, what will happen? They bind to the, when the insulin are given by the intravenous route, suppose it, when the insulin are given by the subcutaneous route, from the subcutaneous route they are absorbed into the circulation. They are absorbed into the circulation, but they are bind to the protamine. These insulin particles are, they are bind to the protamine, polypeptide protamine. So what will happen? Because they are bind to the polypeptide protamine, so dissociation of the insulin from the this polypeptide protamine at the neutral pH is duration is increased. Duration of the release of is increased because of the their dissociation. The timing of the dissociation is increased. So the their onset of action become the late comparing to the short acting insulin or the rapid acting insulin. Okay, I will repeat. I forget to mention the why the rapid acting insulin, they are the rapid onset of the action. The rapid acting insulin, they are the rapid onset of the action because we know that the insulin insulin is a chain of the A chain of the amino acids and the B chain of the amino acid. A chain consists of the 21 amino acids. The B chain consists of the 30 amino acids. So that is a conventional insulin. That is a conventional insulin. But this this rapid acting insulin, they are matured by the recombinant DNA technology. So what is basically the recombinant DNA technology? That is the readjustment of the amino position of the amino acid which is present in the A chain and the B chain. So that readjustment is done during the development. So what will happen? That adjustment makes the monomer of the molecules, monomer of the insulin. Monomers mean the one molecule of the insulin. So one molecule of the insulin is the, what will happen? The molecular size of the insulin is reduced. So when the molecular size of the insulin is reduced, what will happen? When they are given by the subcutaneous route, that immediately absorbed into the circulation because of their smaller molecular size, and they reaches to the site of the action. So their onset of action is increased there. Okay. And in short acting insulin, hexamers of the molecules are there. Hexamers of the insulin molecules means the molecular size of the short acting insulin is 6 times larger than the rapid acting insulin. Because of that, their duration of action is increased comparing to the rapid acting insulin. And here in the intermediate acting insulin, what will happen? Hexamers of the short acting, this crystalline zinc insulin, that means the six monomers combined together to form the one hexamer of the insulin molecules. So one hexamer, it is again combined to the protamine, polypeptide protamine. So because of that, the dissociation of the insulin molecules, that is the hexamer insulin molecules from the this protamine sulfate is delayed. So that, because of that reason, it reaches to the target site late comparing to the short acting insulin. That is the intermediate acting. So that is the reason the intermediate acting insulin, they are the intermediate reaction comparing to the short acting insulin. Okay, is there any confusion? Okay, now onset of action, again 1 to 2 hours. Okay, comparing to the short acting insulin, 30 hours to the 1 hour is a 1 to 2 hours. Peak effect, again 4 to 6 hours. Okay, and the duration of action is about the more than 12 hours. And it should be administered subcutaneously. We know that the route of administration is the subcutaneously. and can be given with a shot of the rapid acting insulin. Why it is given with a shot of the intermediate acting insulin? Basically, they are because intermediate acting insulin, they are basically given to mimic the timing of the physiological basal insulin secretion. Okay, now rapid acting insulin, the short acting insulin, why they are giving to mimic the physiological bolus insulin secretion? Because the duration of action of the rapid acting insulin is approximately 3 to 5 hours. Okay, so they are only able to mimic the timing of the bolus insulin secretion, physiological bolus insulin secretion. The rapid acting insulin, its onset of action is late, 1 to 2 hours. Okay, intermediate acting insulin, 1 to 2 hours, and then the peak effect is the 4 to 6 hours. So they are able to mimic the timing of the physiological basal insulin secretion. So that the intermediate acting insulin, they are given to mimic the timing of the physiological basal insulin secretion. So while giving the insulin, again, similarly for the long acting insulin also, they are also giving to mimic the timing of the physiological basal insulin secretion. Okay, now to mimic the timing in the process of the physiological basal insulin secretion. Okay, we know that throughout the 24 hours, there are two types of the insulin secretion: physiological bolus insulin secretion and the physiological basal insulin secretion. You know about the physiological bolus insulin secretion immediately after the meal, for up to 2 hours after taking the meal, and the physiological basal insulin is a minimal amount of insulin secretion in between the meal. We can say the 2 hours after taking the meal and until the next meal is taken. Okay, now that happens normally in healthy person, but in diabetic patient, as we know that the pancreatic beta cells, they are not able to secrete the insulin, so we need to give the insulin exogenously. So here also the insulin should be given in such a way that they should mimic the timing of the physiological bolus and the physiological basal insulin secretion. How that can be done? They can be done by giving the insulin in combination. Okay, rapid acting insulin or the short acting insulin plus intermediate acting insulin or the long acting insulin. That means one should be the rapid acting or the short acting insulin to mimic the timing of the physiological bolus insulin secretion, and insulin should be the intermediate or the long acting insulin to mimic the timing of the physiological basal insulin secretion. Okay, any confusion till now? Is there any confusion?
No, sir.
Should I continue?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now long acting insulin. Again, the long acting insulin, there are two types of the long acting insulin: insulin glargine and insulin tetramer. Okay, the long acting insulin, their onset of action is long. They do not have the peak effect. And the intermediate acting, and the duration of action is also more than 24 hours. Okay, insulin glargine. Onset of action is about 1 to 5 hours. Okay, no peak effect. Acidic PS. They consist of the acidic PS. No peak effect. And the duration of action is up to the 24 hours or the more. Okay, and they are generally taken at the bedtime. They may be taken if the duration of action is up to 24 hours or the more. That means the single dose for the 24 hours. Is sufficient enough, and the route of the administration is the subcutaneous. Okay, so onset of action is 1 to 5 hours. Okay, there's no peak effect, and the acidic pH is there, and duration of action is more than 24 hours, and generally taken at the bedtime. They may be given at the morning time, but they're generally taken at the bedtime. Why at the bedtime? We will discuss about that in later in picture also. Okay, and they must be given by the subcutaneous route. Okay, I think everything is clear here. So they must be given, this long acting insulin, they must be given to mimic the timing of the physiological basal insulin secretion. Okay, now insulin tetramer, they are also the long acting insulin. They are soluble. Okay, neutral pH, glargine is the acidic pH, this is the neutral pH. Okay, and the onset, okay, that is not necessary. Important thing is that you have to know about the onset of the action is about the 1 hour. There's no peak effect, and the duration of action is about 24 hours. Okay, that's the insulin tetramer. Have you heard about the insulin Lantus? Lantus one ko insulin that is commonly used, that is the insulin pen ma onset. That is the insulin glargine. Okay, we can discuss in this picture though. Okay, now pre-mixed insulin preparation. Why the insulin preparation are the pre-mixed? The insulin picture are the pre-mixed, so that they are able, that is the premixed of the long acting or the rapid acting, sorry, short acting or the rapid acting plus long acting or the intermediate acting. So they are able to match the timing or the process of the physiological bolus and the physiological basal insulin secretion. That is the NPH is neutral protamine hadron, 70%, 30% is the regular insulin. Okay. This is the preparation. This is just the preparation. Anything could be the preparation. Okay. 50% NPS and the 50% NPS is a neutral product. That's a intermediate act. That's sorry. Intermediate acting insulin and the regular insulin. Intermediate acting insulin and the rapid acting insulin. Intermediate acting insulin or the rapid acting insulin. And other could be the long acting insulin plus the short acting or the long acting plus the rapid acting insulin. Anything. Okay. Intermediate plus the rapid or the short acting insulin or the intermediate or the long acting plus the rapid acting or the short acting insulin. Okay. This is not necessary. You have to only remember that the insulin should be given in the premix insulin preparation. The objective of the premix insulin preparation is to mimic the process and the timing of the physiological bolus and the physiological basal insulin secretion. So they are either present in the form of the rapid acting or short acting plus intermediate acting or the long acting insulin. Okay, two insulin can be given: rapid or intermediate, rapid or long acting, short and intermediate. Or short and the long acting. Anything can be given to mimic the timing of the physiological bolus and the physiological basal insulin secretion. Okay. Is there any confusion? We have already discussed about that. Okay. Now, in this picture, it will be very easy if you discuss in this picture. Okay. You can say this one in vertical line, in the horizontal line. Okay. Can you see the picture?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, this vertical line. That is a timing. That's a 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour, 4 hour, and so on. That's a timing in hour. Okay. 24 hours. Okay. And this horizontal line and the vertical line, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is the plasma glucose level. That is the ability of the insulin to control the plasma glucose level. That is glucose infusion rate. That is the determined by the vertical line. Okay. You can see here, we can see this one is the insulin, rapid acting insulin lispro, aspart, and the glulisin. This one is the insulin is given here and it attains the peak effect and then it is declined. Okay. And here the effect is neutralized. Okay. And this one is the regular insulin, same. The effect is being increased, peak effect and being declined. And you can see that again for the NPS, this is the intermediate acting insulin, the NPS, same. And this one is the long acting insulin. Insulin D-dimer is the black one, and the red one is the insulin glargine. Okay, and this is the long acting insulin. You can see that peak effect is present. Peak effect of the rapid acting insulin is present. Peak effect of the regular insulin is present. The peak effect of the intermediate insulin is also present. But the peak effect of the insulin D-dimer, the insulin glargine is not present. That means the constant release of the insulin is given. Constant release of the insulin is given is there in the insulin D-dimer and the insulin glargine. Okay. Again, we will go for the onset of action. The onset of action of the insulin lispro and insulin aspart and the glulisin is the faster than the regular insulin. Okay. Again, the onset of action of the regular insulin is a bit later than the rapid acting insulin, but the faster than the intermediate acting insulin. And similar to the onset of action of this NPS, intermediate acting insulin is a bit later than the short acting insulin, but a bit faster than the long acting insulin. And the onset of action of the long acting insulin and this insulin G-dimer and the glargine is a bit later than the NPS and the faster than the Kuriwana Dai. Okay. And again, you can see the duration of action also. Yes, duration of action. Duration of action of the insulin lispro is smaller. And again, the duration of action of the regular insulin is the larger than the short acting insulin. And again, the duration of action of this intermediate acting insulin is the larger than the short acting insulin. And this duration of action of this we can see this insulin long acting insulin is the approximately 24 hours, and in insulin glargine is more than the 24 hours. Okay. You can remember this by picture also. But the important thing is here, what are the advantages of the rapid acting insulin over the regular insulin, and what are the advantages of the long acting insulin over the intermediate acting insulin? Okay. Initially, what happened when we go for the timeline of the history of the timeline of the development of the insulin? Initially, the conventional insulin were developed. Conventional insulin, one of the examples of the conventional insulin is also the regular insulin. Okay, so what was the problem with the regular insulin? Because we know that the regular insulin, short acting insulin, they are given to mimic the timing of the physiological bolus insulin secretion. But the problem was there, sometimes because of their rapid onset of action of 30 minutes to the when they are given, sometimes we are given even before the meal, the onset of action was 30 minutes to the 1 hour, 30 minutes to the 1 hour. Okay, but 30 minutes to the 1 hour, but when the meal is taken, what will happen? The plasma glucose level immediately raised to the maximum amount, to the maximum amount in diabetic patient. So what was the problem with the regular insulin was there? Immediate two problem was there. Regular insulin were not able to match the timing of the physiological bolus insulin secretion. So immediately the problem was the two problem was there. There are two problem: immediate postprandial hyperglycemia, immediate postprandial hyperglycemia, because when the plasma glucose level is increased immediately after taking the meal, the regular insulin were not able to initiate their onset of action. So the immediate problem was the postprandial after taking the meal, immediate postprandial hyperglycemia. Okay, and once the regular insulin initiate their onset of action, their duration of action were a bit longer. We can say up to the 6 hours to 8 hours. So what was the problem there? Some were years. We can say some were year, 2 or 3 hours. Some were year. The glucose level become the normalized. When the effect is increases and it attains the peak effect, and someone here the glucose effect is normalized, the plasma glucose level become the normal, but the effect of the regular insulin is persistent here. So that further leads to the immediate late postprandial hypoglycemia. That was the problem with the regular insulin, because mismatch with the timing of the physiological bolus insulin secretion, there were the chances of the immediate postprandial hyperglycemia and the immediate late postprandial hypoglycemia. So that to overcome that limitation, this rapid acting insulin was developed, like insulin dispro, insulin aspart, and insulin glulisine by technology. That's a recombinant DNA technology. There's a readjustment of the amino acid and the A chain of the insulin and the B chain of the insulin. That is not necessary. So what was the, because of their rapid onset of action and because of their shorter duration of action, they were able to mimic the timing of the physiological bolus insulin secretion. So they were able to overcome the limitation of the regular insulin, that were the immediate postprandial hyperglycemia and the late postprandial hypoglycemia. Okay, is that clear? Any confusion? That were the advantages of the rapid acting insulin over the regular insulin. Okay, again, the intermediate acting insulin and the long acting insulin. What were the advantages of the long acting insulin over the intermediate acting insulin? The one was the advantages was the peak effect. Suppose intermediate insulin they were given to mimic the timing of the physiological basal insulin secretion. Okay, so at the daytime there was not any problem, because at the daytime the patient taken the early breakfast, early morning meal, early breakfast meal, evening breakfast or snacks, and night dinner also. But at the bedtime, when the insulin is given at the bedtime, this intermediate insulin is given at the bedtime, and the next meal is taken in the early morning, we can say that 8 hours after the early morning. So what will happen? There was the 8 to 10 hours no snack or the meal is taken. So the problem with the intermediate acting insulin were there because of their peak effect. The problem were there, they were the nocturnal hypoglycemia because of their peak effect. Okay, to overcome that peak effect, this long acting insulin were developed. So what was the advantages of the long acting insulin? When this long acting insulin they are given by a subcutaneous route, they form a small depot at the subcutaneous route. From there the insulin is released at the constant amount to the circulation. So from there the insulin reaches to the target site at the constant, smaller amount of the, but smaller than the necessary amount of the insulin reaches to the target site, at constant amount. No peak effect is there. Uniform release of the insulin is there. So because of that, the chances of the to overcome the limitation of the intermediate active insulin, that is the nocturnal hypoglycemia, there were the development of the insulin D-dimer and the insulin glargine. Because they release the insulin at constant uniform. There is a uniform release of the insulin at the constant amount from the site of the administration. So the nocturnal hypoglycemia were able to control. The chances of the nocturnal hypoglycemia with the insulin D-dimer and the insulin glargine were minimal comparing to the intermediate acting insulin. Okay, so the advantages of the regular insulin, rapid acting insulin over the regular insulin is that they minimize the chances of the immediate postprandial hyperglycemia and the late postprandial hypoglycemia. And the advantages of the long acting insulin over the intermediate acting insulin is that they minimize the chances of the nocturnal hypoglycemia. Okay. Now the route of the administration. Okay. Route of the administration. We know that the subcutaneous route is the main route. Is the subcutaneous route. You know about that subcutaneous route. But in case of the diabetic emergency diabetic condition like the diabetic ketoacidosis, non-ketotic hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state. The diabetic ketoacidosis, that it is the complication of the type 1 diabetes mellitus. And the non-ketotic hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state is the complication of type 2 diabetes mellitus. Okay, detail mein jaanu padega na. In brief, we will discuss in the coming classes. Okay, they are the diabetic ketoacidosis. Okay, diabetic ketoacidosis or non-ketotic hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state. They are given by the intravenous infusion. Similarly, the hyperkalemia to control the blood glucose level in the hyper. For the treatment of the hyperkalemia, they were also given by the intravenous infusion route. Intravenous infusion, they are the route of the administration. Basically, the route of the administration is the subcutaneous, but the route is of the intravenous or the diabetic, like in emergency diabetic condition, like diabetic ketoacidosis, non-ketotic hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state, and the hyperkalemia. Okay, okay, that is a simple thing here. No need to mention in detail this thing. Okay. Okay, now the insulin delivery system. Okay, we will try to finish this topic. Three slides are there. Insulin delivery system. Okay, insulin is given by the subcutaneous route. Okay, but how the insulin is delivered? Drug delivery system. So number one is the standard delivery, that is the needles and the syringes. And the number two is the portable pen injector, that is also called the insulin pen. And the number three is the third delivery system is the continuous subcutaneous insulin infusion device. That is the insulin pump. Okay, you can see here. This one is the needle and the syringe. There is a standard delivery system is the needle and the syringe. Conventional and the standard delivery system is needle and the syringe. Okay, this one is the regular insulin in the vial, and this one is the insulin syringe. Small syringe is there. And this one is the unit, not the milliliter. That is a unit. One unit, two unit. That is a unit. One unit, two unit, three unit, four unit. 10 unit, 20 unit, 30 unit, 40 unit. One to ten. Unso yo one ko 10 unit unso. So 1 unit, 2 unit, 3, 10 unit, 20. It is something like that. And the needle is there. It is attached to the needle. This one is the syringe. This one is the needle. And needle are the replaceable. Insulin is withdrawn into the syringe. And the insulin is given through the subcutaneous route. And the site of the insulin administration are the inner aspects of the thighs or the lower part of the abdomen or the inner aspects of the thigh, because the abundant amount of the subcutaneous tissues are available there. So that is the site of the administration. Okay, and the route of the administration is the subcutaneous route. Okay, this one is the needle and the syringe. Okay, and I think you know about this. This is called the insulin pen. This is the pen-like structure. Okay, and this one is the cap of the insulin. This one is the cap of the insulin, and this one is the insulin pen. Okay, basically three or four features are there. This one is the needle, and it's a replaceable. This needle is a replaceable, and this one is the cartridge. This cartridge contains the insulin. Okay, insulin cartridge is there, and this one is the. You can see the point here, at the back of the insulin, it is rotable. This rotable structure is there, so that when we rotate that structure, it will show the how much unit of the insulin should be given. Suppose here the 14 unit is given, it is rotated like that, and the insulin is put over the site of the administration, and it is just punch. It is just punch like a pen, no? Just punch like a pen. So insulin is administered into the insulin administered subcutaneous region, and from there insulin reaches to the site of the action. This is the insulin pen. What are the advantages of the insulin pen over the needle and the syringe? They're easy to use, and they are easy to carry. Banale. Suppose if the diabetic patient, if he or she has to be go to the job, it is a bit difficult to carry the needle and the syringe, but it is easy to carry the insulin pen, just like a pen. So easy to use and easy to carry is the advantage of the insulin pen. They consist of the three structure: needle, this one is the needle, and this one is the cartridge, and this one is the rotable structure. That determines the unit, how much unit has to be given, and then the needle is put to the site of the administration a bit, and then it is pressed, and the bottom of the insulin pen is pressed, so the amount of the insulin reaches to the site of the action. This is the insulin pen. Okay, and the third is the insulin pump. That is the continuous subcutaneous insulin infusion device, insulin pump. Basically, it is used in the ICU setup. When the constant amount, when the insulin has to be given for the 24 hours or the more constantly. So it basically consists of the three structures. This one is the insulin pump. It contains the insulin reservoir, and the software is there. That software is okay. We will discuss about the software later. Okay, insulin pump. It consists of the reservoir, and the reservoir is connected to tiny tubular structure. There's a tube, plastic tube, we can say the flexible tube, okay, for the delivery of the insulin from the reservoir to the site of the action. Here the cannula is there. That cannula, it contains the needle. The needle is attached to the subcutaneous region of the lower part of the abdomen, and the software is initiated in such a way that the software is developed in such a way that releases the constant amount of the insulin, that it releases the constant amount of the insulin from the reservoir, and from the reservoir the insulin enter into the tube, and from the tube to the cannula, it reaches to the subcutaneous tissue and then to the site of the action. This is the insulin pump. That's a continuous subcutaneous insulin infusion device. Okay, that is usually given in the ICU setup when the insulin has to be given continuously for the 24 hour. That is an insulin pump. So they are the standard drug delivery system. Needle and they are the drug delivery system of the insulin. Needle and the syringe, insulin pump, and the insulin pen. Okay.